When I looked into the history of Charles Coulomb and his equation, I found that he was one of the most influential engineers of the 1700s. And his accomplishments are even more impressive when you consider that his background was decent, but not considered good enough for the status-focused people in charge. Even worse, his father lost the family fortune, he had a boss that almost killed him, and he lived in one of the more turbulent times in history. Ready for the story? Let's go!
Electricity, 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 electricity.
Before I start the story of Charles Coulomb, I have to warn you that I could only find two portraits of the man, so I kind of overused them. Anyway, Charles Augustin Coulomb was born in the south of France in 1736 to a middle-class aristocratic family. His father was a government administrator. When he was around 10 years old, his father got a job in Paris, and Coulomb started attending the local school. However, his lineage wasn't good enough to be a full-time student. You needed four generations of noblesse. So instead, he became what was called a martinet, or audited the classes. When he was a bit older, he entered the College Royal, where he was mistreated a bit for his background, but he had a fantastic math teacher and fell in love with mathematics. His mother was distraught as she wanted him to be a doctor, but his father, who was described by a contemporary as a good-natured and unsuspecting fellow, didn't seem to care, but also seemed to have a lack of mathematical skills himself, as his father then lost all the family money in the stock market. Legitimately frustrated, Coulomb's mother, Catherine, kicked Coulomb's father, Henry, out of the house, and Henry went back to his hometown of Montpellier. Coulomb's mother, who still had some money left that she had inherited, tried to blackmail Charles into becoming a doctor, but he rebelled and left Paris and went to live with his father in Montpellier. He didn't have very many options. He could join the priesthood or he could join the military as an engineer. Coulomb decided on the military and joined a military academy in 1760 when he was 24 years old. At that school, he took classes in experimental physics from the scientist Abbé Nollet, who was considered France's leading electrician. Anyway, after about a year of instruction, Coulomb became a lieutenant in the military engineering corps. And after spending 2 years doing geological mapping, he was transferred to the island of Martinique. 28-year-old Coulomb ended up being a lead engineer designing Fort Bourbon, a 6 million livre project with 600 workers. Coulomb was a superb engineer and ended up being promoted to captain after only 6 years of work. Unfortunately, he also got very ill with a tropical disease and asked his superior, named Leboeuf, to let him be transferred back to France for his own health. Leboeuf agreed and in 1770 wrote to Versailles asking for Coulomb to be transferred home for his, quote, future value to the state. Then 5 days later, Leboeuf had a change of heart and realized that this would be a good way for Leboeuf to get home. So he wrote another letter to Versailles saying that he, Leboeuf, was ill and needed to come home. But it was okay as Coulomb could take care of things as Coulomb, quote, has been in charge of the work at Fort Bourbon since the beginning and whom I have decided to keep here for the next year. Poor Coulomb took another 2 years to return to France. According to a biographer, Coulomb's health was so affected by his illness during the 8-year tour of duty in Martinique that he was never again a well man. Back in France, Coulomb wrote a paper about using calculus to determine building stability. The encyclopedia says that his paper of 1773 contains, quote, almost an embarrassment of riches, including a theory of soil mechanics that remains in use today in basic engineering practice. In 1777, the Paris Academy had a competition to design a very low friction compass to detect magnetic disturbances during the day. As the traditional compass of a small magnet on a pivot had too much friction to record the variations that they were looking for. Coulomb worked on it for over a year and co-won the prize for a magnet held up by a thin silk string. This inspired him to start working on the physics of friction, which he published in 1781. An author of a book about friction wrote in 1956 that, quote, Coulomb's contribution to the science of friction were exceptionally great. Without exaggeration, one can say that he created this science. Back to Coulomb and his magnet. The Paris Academy was impressed and installed a version in their observatory. But unfortunately, it turned out to be too sensitive. As an historian wrote, the compass twitched when the assistant sneezed or when the door opened and trembled when carriages passed the street. Coulomb attempted to isolate the needle in a chamber free from any drafts, but it would still often move when the assistant touched the outside. Coulomb eventually figured out that the person walking to the compass would often gain a little bit of electric charge, which would then make the needle sway electrically, not magnetically. Eventually, they grounded the needle and the outside and the person, and it seemed to solve the problem. However, the twitchy needle gave Coulomb an idea. Maybe he could use the twisting force to study the electrostatic force. See, the problem with studying static electricity is that usually the forces are so slight that you can only see movements of little pieces of fluff or a feather, or if wealthy, gold foil. Most scales cannot measure such minute forces. Coulomb decided to study the force of twisting, called the torsional force. He wondered if twisting items worked in a similar manner to springs in what is called Hooke's law. Robert Hooke was a scientist who lived 100 years before Coulomb in the time of Newton. Fun fact, Hooke claimed that he had proved that the force of gravity depends on 1 over the distance squared before Newton did, but he didn't want to share it, claiming he would, quote, conceal it for some time, that others might know how to value it. Hint, Hooke never revealed it. Some laws Hooke did reveal and understand were about springs. First, Hooke found that for moderate disturbances, the amount springs compress or stretches is direct proportion to the force on the spring. So if you double the force, you double the amount the spring stretches. And how much a spring stretches with a given force depends on the strength of the spring, called the spring constant. Therefore, if you know the spring constant and you know the amount the spring is displaced, then you can know the force on the spring. This is how most simple spring scales work in like a grocery store today. Hooke also determined that if you pull a spring and let it go, it will oscillate up and down at a steady rate until it stops. Therefore, the frequency of the spring's vibration is solely due to the mass on the spring and the spring constant, not the amount you pull the mass. It also means you can use the spring's vibration time to determine the spring constant. Coulomb then took piano wires and twisted them to measure how they vibrate. He was pleased to find that the wires twisted back and forth at a constant rate. This implies that twisting follows Hooke's law, that the twist is proportional to the force. In addition, Coulomb used the time it took for the wire to vibrate back and forth to measure the twisting spring constant. Then, all Coulomb needed was a bar on a piano wire, and the amount it moved would tell him the force on the bar. Coulomb had just invented the world's most precise measuring device, where a degree on the scale was equivalent to the weight of 1/100,000th of a single grain of sand. Of course, I call it simple, but the actual experiment was incredibly difficult. And the machine was described by a contemporary as an all too unsteady twisting machine. Still, the torsion scale was used for all kinds of scientific experiments. In fact, torsional balances are still used for scientific experiments. In 1785, Charles Coulomb experimentally determined that the electrostatic repulsive force from 2 charges depended on 1 over the distance squared, confidently writing, "Fundamental law of electricity, the repulsive force that the 2 small balls electrified with the same kind of electricity follows the inverse proportion of the square of the distance between the center of the balls." It was a bit more difficult to measure the attractive forces, but the following year he experimentally proved that opposite forces follow the same rule. And in 1786 he wrote, quote, "The force, either repulsive or attractive, from 2 electrified objects is due to the electrical fluid in the 2 electrical objects an inverse of the square of the distances. Now, Coulomb wasn't the first person to predict that the electric forces look like gravitational force, but he was the first to experimentally validate it. And this law is justly named Coulomb's law. The constant is named Coulomb constant, and the value of charge is measured in coulombs in his honor. Amazingly, Coulomb accomplished all of this when his life was kind of chaotic. In 1783, Coulomb was commissioned to determine the feasibility of canal and harbor improvements in Brittany. However, when he determined that the plan was ill-conceived, the people hoping to profit off the scheme actually had Coulomb placed in jail for his opinions. He ended up being freed within a week. And for a while, the incident actually improved his standing with the people in government. But that didn't help much in 1789 when the French Revolution began. And his mentors were thrown out of power and sometimes, like his friend Lavoisier, lost their heads. At first, Coulomb was a little nervous about staying in Paris. And in 1791, 55-year-old Coulomb quit his position with the military. And for a while, he hid in the countryside with his very young girlfriend, Louise, and their baby, Charles. By 1795, the new leaders had a change of heart and invited him back to Paris to be one of the first experimental physicists at the new Institute of France. By 1802, Charles Coulomb was made the Inspector General of the public schools. And with this new important position, he decided to marry Louise and legitimize their now two children. However, by 1806, Coulomb's illnesses from his time in Martinique caught up with him, and he died of a slow fever at the ripe age of 70. He's been honored by France ever since. In fact, 83 years after his death, Gustave Eiffel had Coulomb's name engraved on the side of the Eiffel Tower. Thanks for watching. I have a ton of videos about the history of electricity. I have quite a few videos about the history of quantum mechanics. You should check them out. My next video is some tricks about how to use Coulomb's law to solve some of these problems with a lot of math. Yum math. Anyway, please give me a thumbs up. Share it on social media. Thank you to my patrons. And if you want to, you can join their ranks because that would be fun. Okay, have a good day.
Well, man.
What the hell? It's Birdie Central.